As the sun sets at the end of a New York workday, the mind transitions from daily tasks to the cloudier, more philosophical regions of social issues, culture, and politics. In a democracy, every perspective on the world is important, and people in art and culture have surprising bodies of knowledge that can shed fresh light on today's reality. The following conversation with Francis Cape took place in Narrowsburg, New York, on April 5th, 2021.
Francis Cape is an English artist living in New York State. Trained as a master carver, Cape turned his skill at woodworking into conceptual art, creating furniture and architectural environments that speak to social injustice, poverty, and sometimes idealism, such as his celebrated series of utopian benches. Has it always pretty much been furniture what you've done, or did you start in other mediums before that?
It depends on how far back you go. I was apprenticed as a wood carver, so wood was my original medium, but I was a carver, I wasn't a furniture maker, although we had cabinet makers in the shop. It was a traditional craft shop.
Mm-hmm. Like applied arts?
Applied arts, absolutely, yeah. And I did a traditional five-year apprenticeship. And I came out of that and went to art school because I wanted to know basically what my contemporaries in the 20th century were doing, because we were doing almost entirely restoration work or reproduction work. I was stuck in the 18th century, although I was 21 years old and it was 1970s. And I got the art bug, and I didn't work with wood for quite a long time because it was a way I kind of had to distance myself from it. And it was something like 10 years later that it came back in, and it just, the whole thing clicked, and it felt totally right, totally comfortable. And so since whenever that was, 1990, 1991, it has always been wood-based, mostly furniture-based, although as you've just seen in the studio, there's some carving reappeared just recently.
How does one make the leap, though, from doing something that's kind of a métier to fine arts, where there's more of a concept required?
It took a while because the art school I went to was a very traditional art school. It was called City and Guilds of London Art School, and we did figure work. We worked from the figure the whole time. And I came out of school, and I was doing that. I was making reliefs, figurative reliefs. And I got to a point where, essentially, I'd been working on my own in the studio for a few years and not been getting the work out of the studio, wasn't happy with anything I'd done, and decided it was time to either quit or give it one last push, or both, one after the other. And so I decided on the one last push thing and reapplied to every graduate school I'd applied to the first time. I've actually been turned down by more graduate schools than probably anybody. and to Skowhegan. And Skowhegan accepted me, and that was great. And I came over and had a great summer over here and went back, having again been turned down by all the same graduate schools, and accosted the heads of the Goldsmiths MA on a crosswalk. Mm-hmm. And told them they'd made a mistake turning me down. And somebody dropped out and they called me.
Wow.
And it's about the only time in my life I've had that kind of chutzpah.
Like on. A Hollywood moment there.
So then it was, I had a friend who was there the year before, so I had begun to get initiated to that kind of way of thinking. And so it's a deep immersion in that.
How you got to the point where you started looking at furniture as something that could suggest more in terms of meaning.
The work that I've been doing for 20 or 30 years now has really started with an idea or something I wanted to work on or work about. Quite often in quite a broad way. And the fact that I work just in wood and for a long time just in furniture or in architectural forms was this very narrow channel that I had to get these ideas through. And for many people that would have been a constraint, but for me it actually turned out to be a strength, because I only had one way of saying things, and I had to make that way say the things that I wanted to say. So for me it's never been about context or about placement. It's always been about something else that was riding with the work. With the work that I did coming out of Goldsmiths right up until about 2004, it was about the relationship between art viewing and the gallery or the gallery museum setting. And I made, classically I made these installations that were, I call them built-in pieces, because they were literally built into the gallery or the museum, and then they were destroyed when they came out. So they were inseparable. You couldn't have them. You could have them in the sense of seeing them, but you couldn't own them because you couldn't take the thing away. And that was part of a broader sense to me of the inseparability of knowing from structures of knowledge. You wouldn't get that by looking at the work that I was doing.
Right.
But there was always that kind of thing underlying the work. In 2004, when Bush was reelected, I felt that I needed to start making work that addressed issues outside the studio, outside the art context.
Because one of those pieces was a sort of like Emily Dickinson piece,
that
right?
That was an Emily Dickinson piece, yeah.
Right.
That was sort of towards the end of that time. That was done at Wave Hill, absolutely, yeah.
So the step into politics then?
The step into politics was a necessary leap. I had no idea how to do it. And when I lecture, I quote my neighbor who said, you can't make political work out of wood, Francis.
Doris Salcedo does it. She does it.
She does it
pretty
beautifully.
Well.
She
yeah.
does it beautifully. Absolutely. And so, in fact, it was, in a sense, it was the same, a specific geopolitical situation, which was Katrina hitting New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
And my ending up down there working, that opened up a way of making work about it. But it included photography, as you know, and that work, and then the bodies of work that came immediately after that.
Mm-hmm.
The photograph, as well as the built object together, spoke about what it is that was my concern.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't, for me, just what happened in New Orleans. It was that what we saw in New Orleans was revealing what I see in the trailer park down the street here,
right.
which is poverty and social injustice in this mm-hmm. country. So, after New Orleans work, I was able to make the transition to some work that spoke about that more broadly.
Yeah, the trailer houses in New Orleans were about temporary lodging for people who, they're the FEMA trailers too, of course,
trailers, yeah.
helping out, but also the lodging people are in as they're parked outside their damaged homes, basically, right? Also with all this ejected stuff. All the furniture that gets thrown out onto the street, all the belongings. They're almost kind of like a sort of convulsion of people's ideas of home. Is that what you saw that interested you there?
Really, it was the fact that those people had done what we are encouraged to do. They had taken out mortgages, they'd bought stuff, kind of under the unspoken promise that the government was taking care of things like floods.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about utopian benches then. It feels to me like it's a little less, it's a little more abstract as a project. What got you interested in intentional communities and how that results in these benches and how they operate?
All of my adult life, it's certainly in the West, the predominant political culture has gone in one direction. And so if you think of my adult life as having started in the late 1960s, when I joined adulthood, shall we say, for lack of a better term, we were at a point where we thought we were going to change the world or die doing it, but or something else. I mean, the thing was really moving in one direction. When it came around to my first time to vote, it was the Thatcher-Reagan steamroller, and the whole thing changed. When I was thinking about what to do next after the last work we've just been talking about, I was thinking about the fact that really it still is the case in this culture, but it was particularly dire then. There was no sense that there could be another way. The Berlin Wall had gone down. There was the corporate way. There was money. That was it. There was no chance of thinking about another way of doing things. And that contrasted enormously with what I'd had as a young man.
Uh-huh.
The other thing that fed into it is that I had gotten a certain amount of pushback from people when I was talking about my work, about being an outsider and coming and telling Americans how to live their lives, what to think. So I wanted to make work about American idealism. And that was the beginning of the idea. And immediately go to the benches. I had this other idea and I started making a couple of pieces of furniture towards it. And there was this shaker bench sitting in my studio, and I was like, that was just such a solid thing that I didn't have to go anywhere else, and it basically went from there. The whole project is about getting people to talk about other ways of living. How do they do it? How do people live together?
Mm-hmm.
How is it actually happen? What's the mechanics of it?
This relationship between utopian ideas and design, there have been so much, I mean, starting with William Morris and probably beyond that, or even up to Bauhaus, and this idea that design was going to sort of implement some new enlightenment about you know, democracy and you know, sharing and all of these things that would be sort of correctives to capitalism, to modernism, let's say. But that seems to have petered out pretty early on. In fact, I can't think of, IKEA might now be our most best example of that ideal, although I don't know what that has to do with politics at this point. Cheap furniture, I mean.
My study of it, and I did study that, has it ending after the Second World War, when Stalinism made socialism a dirty word. And now the same kind of look, that sleek, pared-down look, actually goes with stacks of money.
Yeah.
I mean, the more money you have, the less baseboard you have, and the kind of cleaner and sharper edge your living place in and your furniture is. So the outer form of the design continued, but the idealism got dropped out. IKEA obviously comes from Sweden, which is where socialism has continues in strength, but IKEA furniture itself is just so badly made that it can't hold up. It can't hold up a body, never mind any kind of
semi-disposable. I mean, I think it's interesting that those ideas were so represented in those forms, especially the Bauhaus, the kitchen as a machine, you know, the organization, the rationalization, the clarity, transparency, all of these values that modern architecture set out to proclaim. And it ends up just being kind of cheaply mass-produced, where labor gets paid less and the company owners get paid more.
Right.
And now, especially in this past year, with, you know, the distribution through Amazon, and those companies were looking at an even, you know, more disgusting, you know, spread in terms of poverty and wealth. But just philosophically, do you think there's any hope to turn this around?
I think that misinformation is huge. I mean, you know, I became a chair of the Democratic Party in this town because I wanted to make the Democratic Party democratic in this town, which, funnily enough, it wasn't. And so democracy is huge to me, and in this country, we don't really have it. And now, visibly, it's being attacked. And what allows that to happen is misinformation. And I think that was the same with Brexit over in the UK.
Yeah.
So there was misinformation about what it would actually mean, and now the chickens are coming home to roost.
Yeah, it's right out of the Nazi playbook, but the cynicism about what truth is to begin with, it's as if everyone suddenly become an amateur philosopher and they're questioning, you know, the rock right in front of them, you know. I don't know how to even really at times argue a political position anymore, because if you're talking to somebody who's on the other side, they have a completely different reality.
Yeah, they do. There isn't any talking to them because they have a completely different set of so-called facts.
Yeah.
Sorry, don't have a solution to that one.
Francis Cape's Utopian Benches will be on view in a group show at the McAvoy Foundation for the Arts in San Francisco starting May 28th, and at the Catskill Art Society this fall. His book, The Other End of the Line, with Paul Kennedy, marking the 10th anniversary of the High Line, was published in October 2020. The following conversation with Moyra Davey took place in Narrowsburg, New York, on April 6th, 2021.
Moyra Davey is an artist working in photography, film, and writing. Combining elements of her own life with those of literary figures from the past, she creates layered stories that bridge time, distance, and fate. Her mailers, photographs folded and sent through the mail, are an earthly manifestation of her ongoing superhistorical interests. You've been photographing during this time, this last year?
I have. I've been mostly shooting video of birds and horses.
I get the idea that that's not a lot different than what you would normally be doing in your, you know, serious art practice, right? Because I think that you mostly observe what's around you, right?
It's a little different in the sense that, I mean, I've been, you know, in the country on and off for years, and we started having these birdhouses and realized that, you know, I could use a telescope and an iPhone, but I actually would have never used those kinds of images in my own work until this year. although I did start I started photographing horses mm-hmm. in 2019, I think. I had a very specific project in mind. I was trying to channel Peter Hujar's animal photographs. Mm-hmm.
He has this knack for seeing this kind of vulnerability in the animals or something like that, mm-hmm. right? I mean, I love his dog pictures.
You know, he was known to talk to them and mm-hmm. coax them and... which he didn't do with his human subjects. You know, I've been thinking about him for a couple of years because I curated a show recently of his work and my work in uh-huh. Berlin, and I love the work. I've always loved it. I think the very first thing I saw was the book Portraits in Life and Death, and then there were two shows in 1989 in New York. Mm-hmm. Which was just the year after I came to New York.
Right.
And
you did a very simple film with one of his books where you thumbed through it
that
backwards,
book,
right?
Portraits in Life and Death.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Tell me about the concept of that book. That film of going through the book mm-hmm. backwards.
I was asked to be in a show. I think it was Josiah McElhenney mm-hmm. was doing a show around the work of Blinky Palermo. Mm-hmm. Honestly, I don't remember how I came to this idea, but I was looking at the book and there was a triangle of light from the setting sun, you know, similar light to right now. And I know almost nothing about Blinky Palermo,
right.
But I know he used a lot of triangles. And the right. book, maybe like a dozen of the photos are taken in the catacombs in Palermo.
Oh, right, right.
So the portraits in Life and Death are the living humans kind of reclining or lying down, and then these...
So literary and formal overlaps, but kind of coincidentally. But it's so interesting, the flipping through the book backwards, though, because that's what we tend to do sometimes if we're looking at something in a kind of sideways.
I almost always look at a book backwards, but I think it's more like it's like physically more comfortable.
Are you left-handed or something?
I'm right-handed.
Yeah.
For some reason, I find it easier.
I'm kind of in some ways leading to a conversation about the way we read. I mean, you've written some great essays, one in particular, about what reading is and how people do it. How are you reading right now? What's your reading like?
I mostly read at night, actually. I read and I fall asleep, and then I wake up numerous times at night.
Uh-huh.
And I read usually for an hour each time.
Mm-hmm.
That's when I read books.
What you're describing about the middle of the night reading and early in the morning, it's before the world intrudes, and it's also a time, almost a time that feels kind of like resistant in a way mm-hmm. to the world we're living in. Maybe it's loud more at night, or there is the feeling that there's nothing going on, and that's when you can escape to your guilty pleasure of actually reading a real book.
Yeah, in the last year I've read a lot of novels, way more than usual. There's like this prohibition. There's like certain kinds of reading are for pleasure, and you don't do that during the day. You only do the reading that's for research, mm-hmm. for writing or whatever. And then at the end of the day, you can indulge in the pleasure reading.
Do you have an active writing project going on at the moment?
Yeah, I started writing something about almost 2 years ago by now. I started going to these dance parties in New York. A friend who is a member of The Loft and another place called Joy, they're like these private parties. But if you're invited by someone, I don't know if you've been to The Loft.
Yeah.
So Jason and I started going, and I started writing about the parties. So that's what I was working on. And then in March, when everything shut down and we moved, didn't know what to do for weeks and mm-hmm. weeks, and I just was kind of pacing around. And but then I started going back to the city for one thing or another, and I would go always walking in Riverside Park, which is really near my building mm-hmm. in Washington Heights, and I started to see that all of this indoor life was now taking place outside in. Mm-hmm. In the park, and I started to write about that.
Does it have a historical link or a...
It does not have a historical link, but it's a funny coincidence that I was just recently reading about Baudelaire and the Flaneur in someone's book. Whose was it? David Campany did this book about dust.
I think it's called A Handful of Dust. That's also the title of an Evelyn Waugh novel.
It's something like that.
Mm-hmm.
There's definitely a Flaneur component to this, this mm-hmm. you know, the part about the parks.
Are you observing these social activities as something, are you thinking about mortality more, I guess is what I'm wondering. Are you thinking about that when looking at people in these situations?
Yeah, I have this odd feeling when I go back to the city. I can't even quite put my finger on it, but it's almost like I'm dead and I've sort of come back. I'm back on Earth. I've died and I'm back on Earth and I'm just sort of observing, through a fishbowl.
It sounds a little like Wings of Desire, that mm-hmm. great Tim yeah. Bender's film, the angels observing people.
Yeah.
Because so much of your work, I always think of it as you in your apartment in Washington Heights, like the monologues, the texts you've written, but you're reading out loud. But also then series like Subway Writers, which is photographs of people writing in the subway, just these kind of discrete observations. But obviously that means something to you to select that and to observe that and make something of it.
Mm-hmm. I'd had the idea to photograph people writing on the subway for a long time, but I couldn't get up my nerve to do it. And then finally I got an invitation from Donald Young in Chicago to do a show. And so I thought, okay, now I'm gonna do these people, scribbling in their notebooks on the subway with a little point and shoot camera. I just started doing it. So the thing is, like, the people writing, they don't see me doing it. People around them see me doing it.
Right, right.
People were simply curious. Mm-hmm. Nobody was antagonized by this, mm-hmm. or I was never confronted. But it's true that I do love to observe. And sometimes I just write descriptions of people who are sitting opposite me mm-hmm. on the subway.
I want to ask you about mediation and the mailers, but also to this thing you do in Les Godesses, where you're reciting a text that you've written, but you're doing it through a recording. You're like listening to your own recording and you're speaking it almost simultaneously.
I started doing it just to solve a purely technical problem, which was my bad memory. And then I went to a performance artist talk by Suzanne Bocanegra, but an artist was listening to a feed of her voice and mm-hmm. I a light went off in my head and I thought, if mm-hmm. I can do this, it'll make my life so much easier.
I don't know if you intended this or not. It seems to represent a kind of like a blip or a disconnect in memory or our understanding of historical texts. You start to own it, I guess. Is mm-hmm. is that what happens?
I mean, I know I quote a lot, and sometimes I'm very self-conscious about that, and sometimes I try and stop quoting and decide, okay, I'm only going to have my own words in this text, but in fact, I never quote unless I've like fully absorbed it and been able to kind of transform it, make it into something mm-hmm. my own.
Mm-hmm. The other thing you do, I think, that's very original and related to the mic and the reading is the mailers, and obviously this is about bringing into the process of making a photograph this idea of the transportation of it, or mm-hmm. the hands it's touched or something like that. But the thing I love about it, it's not precious. I love that it just admits that it's this utilitarian and sentimental
mm-hmm. giant postcard. That's what Chris Krause called
yeah, the
it.
Giant postcard, and also the poster, which is this disparaged.
Just after I made Les Godesses, which was about the Shelleys, the Romantics, and my family, I got access to this incredible archive at the New York Public Library called Shelley and His Circle. So I was taking photographs and close-up of these, incredible late 18th century, early 19th century letters mm-hmm. and diaries, where the paper was made out of cotton, so it's got this incredible mm-hmm. fibrous texture. So I made enlargements of those, and I sent some to my mother and my sisters and my nieces.
So you're reenacting the manuscripts you're looking at, you're reenacting what they had once done.
Yeah. In a way, yeah. But the best one I ever sent in that and that genre was when I was in Paris for 10 months in 2009, and I met a woman who was born on the same day, the same month, 200 years after Mary Wollstonecraft, and her name was Marie, and she's a wonderful person. She's a curator. And so I sent a set to her, and the title of the piece became Mary, Marie.
Would you say you're a collector?
I collect books, but I live with a collector, an incredible collector, and I've taken a lot of photographs.
Photographing is collecting, right? I mean,
yeah.
Trying to document all the time feels like such a burden. It feels not futile, but feels like you're going to be burdened with all this stuff, all these pictures
absolutely.
You have to archive and take care of. Do you feel that way after all these years of taking photographs?
Yeah, definitely. I have binders of negatives and contact sheets.
It's kind of burdensome at a certain point, you know. I think this last year has been an austerity lesson for people. And do you like Eggleston's photographs, like under the bed or in the freezer?
I do very much. And I was definitely influenced by those, his light bulb photographs. They have a very crude look to them.
You think of the people because they're missing the people, something like that.
But also just fascinating because it's looking at something so banal, so ordinary, but it's being transformed by the way the camera sees it. One of the things that photography does so well is to take a cigarette butt and make it look like, you know, something monumental.
Moyra Davey's book titled Index Cards, Selected Essays, was published in 2020. The Shabbiness of Beauty, a book of photographs by Davey and Peter Hujar with an essay by Eileen Miles, comes out in April 2021.